So good afternoon, everybody. This is the sixth lecture. And I will share the screen. Yeah, today's topics, you can see the screen?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes.
Right. So today's topic is Darboux's theorem. And then after that, we'll go to Cauchy-Minvalli theorem, which is important for, very much needed for L'Hopital's rule. And perhaps we'll do the simplest case of L'Hopital's rule. If possible, we'll do what? There are three important cases. I will do all the three, if not today, in the next lecture. Okay. So let us start. So this is Darboux's theorem. What it says, all of you know, if f is a continuous function from AB to R, let's assume that I find a lambda between f of A and f of B, then I know there exists C in between AB, so that fc equal to lambda. This is what is known as intermediate value theorem. So this property is called intermediate value property. What does that mean? You have a function f. Okay. And I say it has intermediate value property. If f of, for a and b in the domain of f, if f of a is less than f of lambda, less than f of b, then there is a C in between A and B, such that f of C equal to lambda. I am saying in between because I am not assuming A is less than B, even though in the pitch, the continuity case, I assume that, but that's not needed. Okay. Now, what does Darboux's theorem say? See, this name is French name, and those of you who know French can pronounce it better. But it is almost like this, and it's between da and da. Da, and there is, I assume one of them. More or less, this is how it's pronounced, but this is not very correct. So you should not pronounce this Darboux or some such thing. That's the only reason I wrote it, Darboux's theorem. Okay, what does it say? Suppose I have a function in f from AB to R. Assume it's a differentiable. Remember, when I say it's a differentiable at the end points, it's only the one-sided derivative. That is limit f of a plus h minus f of a by h, where now h is positive. There it has to come from this side. And similarly, yeah, the other one at b will be f of b minus h minus f of b by h, where h is again positive. Okay, these are the one-sided limits. Okay. So what we are assuming is exactly similar. We want to say f dash has intermediate value property. So what should it mean then? It means that, let us assume f dash of A is less than lambda and less than f dash of B. Then what should be the theorem? It is f dash which has intermediate value property, not f. Because f will automatically have intermediate value property because f is differentiable and hence continuous. Therefore, it will have intermediate value property. That's no theorem. Rather, it's not a theorem here in differentiation. It's a theorem in continuity. Now, what we want to say is f dash has intermediate value property. That means there is a C in between A and B, so that f dash of C equal to lambda. Is the theorem understood? Please say yes if you understand this theorem, the statement. Okay. So the proof is easy, but there is a little subtlety here. Okay, now let us look at how did you prove Rolle's theorem? Do you remember Rolle's theorem, Minvalli theorem, etc.? What we wanted to do was we have the Rolle's theorem. Suppose I wanted to prove Minvalli theorem. What did we do? We found a lambda so that f of x minus lambda x, okay, at a and b it has the same values, right? Find a lambda so that this is g of x, then g of a equal to g of b. Then by Rolle's theorem we know there exists c so that f dash c must be zero. That I would have got the result. Okay, so similar trick is what you want to do here. It's okay, the proof mimics the proof of Rolle's theorem, right? Okay, let us look at, suppose I prove, put g of x equal to f of x minus lambda x. So is this continuous on AB? Yes. Is it differential on AB? Yes. Okay. Yes. So this is differentiable on AB. Is that clear to all? Okay. Because this is differentiable, this is first degree polynomial, therefore this is differentiable. And therefore sum of two differentiable functions, differentiable. Okay. Right. Now what do I want to do? You see that now I am not assuming lambda. This lambda is already given to me. You understand? So I'm not assuming, I'm choosing lambda. Lambda is given to me, therefore there is no choice for me. So what is g dash of x then? You can see it's f dash of x minus lambda. What is the result I want to show? There is a c in between, so that f dash of c equal to lambda. That is f dash of c minus lambda is zero. Right? Therefore, what I want to say? I want to say there is a c in between a, b, so that g dash of c is zero. Okay, I want to think. I can write the proof. I can explain the proof, but I want you to think. Okay? So, do I know any conditions so that the derivative at a point is zero? Can somebody tell me the answer? I'm looking for a point C so that g dash C is zero. Do you have any idea? Somebody, Ruchika, can you tell me what kind of condition I can ask for C?
So that g dash C is zero. Please.
Yeah?
We can use Rolle's theorem, sir.
Can you speak a little louder, please?
Sir, f of g dash of A will be like f dash of A minus lambda.
No, that's all right. Zero. I am looking for, I want to see so that g dash c is zero. Now you should go back in your mind. If you are reviewed, you should be able to come. When do I know the derivative is zero? Is there any condition?
For maximum or minimum at that point.
There is some problem with my mic or something. Just 1 second. Again. So what is the condition on C?
So C must be a local minima or
very good. Local maxima or minima. It shows that you already remember proof of Darboux's theorem. Who is this?
Sir Swaroop.
So you had already seen a Darboux's theorem proof, right?
Yes, sir.
That's why you said C must be local
minima. Yeah, sorry, sir.
That you should not have said, right? That gave the game to me.
Yeah, sorry,
I do not know. I only know that. Therefore, what should I look for? I should look for. See, you see that this is a discovery. What you learned is you checked a proof, you remember the proof. You understand the difference? Swaroop?
Yes, sir.
Now we are discovering. I do not know whether I should look for a maxima or minima. Look for a local extrema. That's the correct word. Since you know the word, the correct thing you said it, it's a minima. But I do not know. Okay, let us do that. Okay, now let's look at. So if there is a local extrema, something should happen. Suppose, why should a local extrema exist? That we do not know. But again, let's go back to Rolle's theorem. How did you argue? Now g is a continuous function. Therefore, g attains a maxima or minima. Okay, maximum and a minimum, not or it's and a minimum. Okay, maximum and minimum. Is that clear? Yeah. Then, see, this is how you should learn. See, what you do, even those who had already learned, you just read the proof, understand. I will not do that. Rolle's theorem, how did you argue? I said either maximum, see, since my condition was f of a equal to g f of b, I said a and b cannot be both maximum. If maximum is attained in a, then maximum attained in b, therefore minimum should be attained interior. Or if a and b are points of minimum, the maximum is attained in interior. That's how we argued. Are you following? If you go back, please go through the proof and recover and read that. That way you will understand better. But you are always thinking in terms of exam, memory, writing. For me, understanding is more important, because that's the way one can create more. Okay. So I know G attains a maximum or minimum, right? Okay. Now let us see. Can G attain? Okay. Now, what did you argue here? A and B, both maximum and minimum cannot, they have to be attained at different points. At least one interior point you should be attained. So similar thing is what I would like to say. Suppose, can A be a local maximum? Be a maximum. I do not know whether local or something. Suppose it's a maximum for G. Then what happens? I have G of X minus G of A by x minus a limit x goes to, this is my a, b, and my x is going to go from here. Therefore, x go to a plus. You understand this? Now, if a is a point of maximum, what is the relation between gx and ga? Gx will be less than or equal to ga. Therefore, gx minus ga, this numerator will be less than or equal to 0, but the denominator is positive. Therefore, what do I get?
We get the whole expression as less than or equal to 0.
The limit, we know the limit exists. It's a differentiable, right?
Yeah.
Therefore, it is g dash a. That should be less than or equal to 0. You understand? But let's look at g dash a. G dash a is f dash a minus lambda. But g dash a is f dash a minus lambda. Is that okay? Yes or no?
No, sir. Here we are coming at a contradiction. Like, the thing we assume that the first.
No. See, don't try to recall what you have learned. Let us go here.
No, what you have assumed just a bit above.
Yes, I assume it's a maximum. Attains a maximum at A, right?
Yeah.
For what function? G. Therefore, what is the relation between gx and ga? Less than or equal to 0. X minus a is greater than 0. Therefore, the limit, I know it exists. Therefore, the limit should be less than or equal to 0. You understand? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Now, what happens to f dash a minus lambda? See, what is our assumption? F dash a is less than lambda. Therefore, that doesn't seem to be any contradiction. Right? Now you see that you assume it's a minimum. So you are trying to look at that and get a contradiction. Do you understand? So there is no contradiction. Perhaps that's what you wanted to say. You follow that?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, that's what you wanted to say. There is no contradiction. So nothing. Maybe B is a maximum. Now let's again look at, just bear with me. I just want to, sorry. Yeah. Limit as x tends to b, b minus, because I have a, b, and x goes from here. How? G of x minus g of b by x minus b. Now again, notice that this fellow is less than or equal to 0, as we argued earlier, because b is a point of maximum. And x minus b, x is less than b, this is also less than or equal to 0. Therefore, the limit which exists, namely g dash b, therefore it is
positive.
But what is g dash b? It is f dash b minus lambda. But f dash b is greater than lambda, therefore this is greater than or equal to 0. Again, no contradiction. Do you understand this? So, There is no contradiction. You follow that? Therefore, what should I look for? Are you following me? So I should look for a minimum now, because maximum does not seem to give a contradiction. So I look for a minimum now. Minimum of G. You understand? Now I want to say, can A be a minimum for G? Okay. Suppose A is a minimum for G, minimum point. Then what should happen? Again, let's look at, maybe I can actually go back to the earlier one. Yeah, notice that this is again A, B, my X is from here. Therefore, GX will be, this is a minimum. Therefore, GX will be greater than or equal to GA. Therefore, this is greater than or equal to 0. This is also greater than or equal to 0. Therefore, this is the limit exists. That's greater than or equal to 0. GA dash A must be. You understand that if A is a minimum for G, then G dash A must be greater than or equal to 0. But what is G dash A? It is F dash A minus lambda. But remember, F dash A is strictly less than lambda F dash B. Therefore, this is negative. You understand? This is strictly negative, whereas you say it must be greater than or equal to 0. This is a contradiction. So what is the conclusion? The conclusion is A cannot be a minimum for G. So please pause, review, and proceed. What did we conclude was, if A is a point of maximum, A or B, I am not going to get any contradiction. Okay, but if A is a minimum for G, I got a contradiction. Okay, let us see whether B could be a minimum for G. Can this happen? Okay, if that be the case, again, let's look at this is limit extends to B minus of G of X minus G of B by X minus B. Again, GX is greater than or equal to GB, therefore this is greater than or equal to 0. But X is greater than or equal to B. Hey, are we doing correctly? X is less than or equal to B. Therefore, this is less than or equal to 0. Therefore, the limit will be less than or equal to 0. The limit is G dash B. Yeah, you understand that? X is less than B. Therefore, X minus B will be less than or equal to 0. And B is a point of minimum. Therefore, GX minus GB will be greater than or equal to 0. And we know G is differentiable at B. Therefore, the derivative exists. The limit exists. The limit is G dash B. That should be less than or equal to 0. But then what is G dash B? That is F dash B minus lambda, right? Because of this is always positive. Therefore, it's a contradiction. So B cannot be a minimum. Okay, this cannot happen and this cannot happen. Therefore, but I know G attains a minimum on AB, and the minimum cannot be A, minimum cannot be B. Therefore, G attains a minimum at some point C in the interval AB. Now, this is in the interior point. Okay. So it attains a minimum on that thing. Therefore, it's a local. Therefore, C is a local minimum. Since G is a local minimum, C is a local minimum, G dash C must be 0. That is F dash of C equal to lambda. So we proved the result, but okay, I will summarize the proof again, but just to take a minute, go through the proof, because textbook will always assume, okay, A cannot be a minimum for G, B cannot be a minimum for C, and then they will start the proof from here. Okay. And if you are a smart guy, you should think that, okay, then why should I work with minimum? Maybe maximum will also work. That should be the natural thought process. But we saw natural thought process, if you assume it's a maximum, there is no contradiction. I am not going to get anything. Think about, see, I'm trying to point out some certain human traits. When I ask you to say, look, it's an extremum, naturally you will take it's a maximum. When I say it's a monotone function, you will naturally assume it's an increasing function, right? When I say it's an end point of an interval, usually you will take the left hand point A, okay? When I take as a monotone sequence, you will take an increasing sequence. When I ask you to take a point in the plane, okay, Euclidean plane, coordinate plane R2, you usually choose a point in the first quadrant. You see that these are all our biases, right? Naturally, you should have worked. Therefore, when it comes to say, I want to adapt Rolle's theorem, then the natural thing is I will look for local extrema. Therefore, I should start with the maximum, okay? Because that's my bias. But teachers and textbook, they know what works and they will write only that. Do you understand the logic? Do you appreciate what I'm doing? How many of you have checked this earlier? Because I could see many of you have done Darboux's theorem. How many of you have thought about maximum point is useless? In my book, I would write it. If you look at my book, I will say that. It may be tempting to use maximum point, you will fail. You won't get it. Do you appreciate this? Good. It took little more than I expected already. This is a 5 minutes job, but it took 24 minutes for us. Is the proof clear now? So the proof actually starts from here. Since G is continuous, it attains a minimum. Okay. I claim minimum cannot be attained in A. This is the argument. I claim minimum cannot be attained in B. This is the argument. Therefore, it attains a minimum at an interior point. Therefore, it's a local minimum. And here G dash is zero. Finished. Proof is very, very easy. This is what I call accountant job. You verify line by line. You think you understood the proof. Okay. But there was a hidden dimension to the proof. Okay. So how many of you appreciate this? If you really appreciate, okay, there's a clap sign. You can do that. Just for fun. Okay. It looks I am kind of feminine. Asking for it. Okay. So I have done Darboux's theorem, which was pending for a long time. Now we want to talk about Cauchy's mean value theorem. The earlier mean value theorem is traditionally known as Lagrange's mean value theorem. It had only one function, F from AB to R. This is continuous on the closed interval, differentiable on the open interval, etc. Right? Then the slope of the chord with joining AFA and BFB is achieved by is equal to the slope of some point in the interior. Slope of the tangent line at the interior. Do you understand this paraphrase? Geometric paraphrase? How many of you understand? Okay. If you want a boring way, f of b minus f of a equal to f dash c into b minus a, which is f of b minus f of a by b minus a equal to f dash of c. Okay. Right. Now, what does Cauchy's mean value theorem say? It deals with two functions. Okay. The hypotheses are essentially the same. A and b are continuous on the closed and bound interval AB and differentiable on the open interval AB, right? Then what I want to say is something like this, f of b minus f of a by g of b minus g of a equal to some f dash of c by g dash of c. This is what you want to say. Notice that this cannot be deduced from Lagrange's theorem. How many of you see that? What is the problem? Since F satisfies the Lagrange's condition, there exists C, so that F of B minus F of C will be F dash of C into B minus A. And similarly, G of B minus G of A will be G dash of C into B minus A. B minus A cancels. So I got the result. What is the mistake in the proof? Can somebody tell me? Are you following what I'm saying?
So will you please repeat? I mean,
sir, both the C might not be the same.
Exactly. Okay, this is, there is a C1, there is a C2. Therefore, it may not be, I may not be able to write it. You understand? What? Therefore, the merit of this is, there is a single C. There is a C in the interval AB. So that is happening. So the C is same for F and G. That's a merit. That's the importance or significance of this theorem. Right? Okay, this is a very easy point. I am sure all teachers will also point out. But what is the geometric meaning? Remember, for Rolle's theorem, we had a geometric meaning. Okay, look at the graph. Look at the chord joining AFA and BFB. Look at the slope. Then that slope is equal to slope of some tangent at some point. Right? That's what we saw. But is there any geometric meaning? I'm sure all of you had gone through some vectors and physics also. You know that if I have an interval AB into R2, usually physicists will denote it by T. T for time, AB they will think of as a time interval. And let's look at a function. I will call it, for the time being, gamma. Gamma of T must be a point in R2. Therefore, it will be X and Y. But remember, X depends on T, Y depends upon T. Do you understand this? And usually what the physicists will think, it is the motion of a particle at time t, it is at the position xt, yt. Okay, this is xt, yt. You understand? Therefore, I can talk of the instantaneous velocity of this movement of the particle at this point. That is, that is called the velocity vector, which is defined by gamma dash equal to x dash of t. That's go component wise, coordinate wise, y dash of t. Do you understand this at least? Sure. Okay. So, yeah, Sashikala, yes.
No, sir, actually, I was about to put tick mark and.
Okay, no problem. Fine. So, now, therefore, what instead of xt, yt, what I'm going to do is let us look at the curve gamma. You may want to do it as x. Okay, let me do it as x. This is f of x into g of x. This is a vector in R2 because f and g are functions from the interval AB to R. This is for x in R, AB. Right? Therefore, I can think of this movement of a particle. Right? Now, I'm drawing a very simple-minded picture. Okay? It can be complicated like this, but let me look at a simple-minded picture. So, this is the point A, and let us say this is the point B, right? And what is the position vector here? F of A and G of A. Here, F of B and G of B. This is A. F of B and G of B, right? Therefore, what is the slope of the chord joining these two? That is F of B minus F of A by G of B minus G of A. You understand this? Therefore, the left side is nothing other than the slope of this. Now, what is this? Remember, gamma dash t is f dash t by g dash t. Therefore, what is the slope of this line? So, this is f dash t, this is a vector, g dash t, this is the vector. Therefore, the slope of the line will be the y coordinate. Sorry, I should have done the other way around. I'm sorry for the mistake. This should have been G of T and F of T. Therefore, it will come in that fashion. You understand why I'm doing? Because slope, how do I write? Y1 minus Y2 by X1 minus X2, right? So this will be gamma of X is equal to G of X, F of X. Therefore, this will be G dash of X and F dash of X at X. Therefore, what will be the slope? Slope will be f dash by g dash. the y coordinate by the x coordinate. Do you understand this? I hope you are not confused. You understand? Just because I want to write in the usual slope formulation, I am interchanging f and g. Okay, gamma x equal to g of x comma f of x. Therefore, the y coordinate becomes f. Right? Therefore, what does it say? Look at the slope of this chord, f of this. Therefore, this is going to be, let me again correct, this is g of a, f of a. This is g of b, f of b. Look at the slope. Okay, that is f of a minus f of b by g of a minus g of b. I got it. Other way around. Okay, then what I want to say, there is a point here. At this point, what is the tangent vector? Gamma dash x, that is g dash x, f dash x. Therefore, what is the slope? Slope is f dash x by g dash x. That's what it says. I hope all of you understood. I'm sorry for the not so legitimate, legible writing, but I hope the meaning is clear. Do you understand? Okay. Now the proof is extremely easy. You just mimic the same proof as you did with Rolle's theorem. So we define, let us say h of x, since I did already f of x, h also I will avoid, h could be an increment. So f of x minus lambda g of x. Okay. And choose lambda, a real number, so that phi of a equal to phi of b. That means f of a minus lambda g of a equal to f of b minus lambda g of b. Therefore, f of a minus f of b bring to this side equal to lambda of g of a minus g of b. Therefore, this by g of a minus g of b will be lambda. Okay. And what now you can see phi is again differentiable. It satisfies all the properties of Rolle's theorem. Okay. Therefore, phi dash of x will be f dash of x minus lambda g dash of x. Right. And phi of a equal to phi of b, therefore there is a c, so that phi dash of c must be zero. Right? Therefore there is a c, since phi of a equal to phi of b, there is a c, of course, in between a and b, so that phi dash c is zero. That means f dash c equal to lambda into g dash c. That means f dash c by g dash c equal to lambda, but lambda is what you wanted. So proof is easy, boringly simple proof. Do you understand this? So as I said, from Lagrange's mean value theorem, I cannot deduce Cauchy's mean value theorem. But on the other hand, I can deduce Lagrange's mean value theorem from Cauchy's mean value theorem. Can somebody tell me how?
Take gx is equal to x.
Right. I'm sure all of you know this, right? So it's no news for you. So if I take gx equal to x, that implies Lagrange's theorem. So in principle, I could have skipped Lagrange's theorem and directly proved this. I could have directly proved Cauchy's mean value theorem. Okay, that's what most of the proofs and books do that, but I avoided. Is it okay now?
Okay, sir.
Good. Now I want to go to L'Hopital's rule, but before that, remember I asked you to go through my lecture on limits. I don't remember the number, continuity lecture 6 or 7, whatever it is. And there I had also explained limit going to infinity as limit x goes to infinity, etc. So let us quickly recall, okay, because I'm sure that some of you may not have done or you still unsure of such things, because many of you infinity is, you deal with as though it's a number. It's not a number. Okay, it's like, you know, you think of God, but then you think of God as a Ram or Krishna or some something human form, but God may not be any of those. Okay, you give a picture. So similarly, infinity is just an ideal, not an ideal in the sense of ring theory. Okay, anyway, I'll explain that. Let us start with two things. Suppose I have sequence an of real numbers. Okay, real sequence. What do I mean by an going to infinity? This is a symbol. You understand that? There is nothing like a number. When I say an tends to infinity, this signifies a behavior of the sequence. That's it. Nothing more. It says something about the behavior of the sequence an. What does it say is the following. You give me any m, okay, real number, then I can find a natural number n, so that whenever k is greater than or equal to n, my ak lies here. That is, ak will be strictly greater than m. Notice that, like convergence, this should be true for the entire tail. After n, capital N, all the terms should be greater than m. Then only you say an diverges to infinity. One usually says diverges to infinity. Okay, but these are all symbols. Real meaning is this. That means you, whatever m you give me, I can find a natural number so that after that n, namely for every k greater than n, my ak should be strictly greater than m. If you look at the numbers like this, 1, 2, draw the graph, this is my n, after that my an, this is my m, y equal to m line, all for any k, my ak will be above this horizontal line, y equal to m. Some, but it should be above. Okay, I hope all of you have seen. I don't know if I take time, then I will not be able to do. Now there are two things. When I say limit x tends to a of fx equal to L, there are various possibilities. My L could be infinity or minus infinity. How do I define minus infinity? A and diverges to minus infinity. Can somebody tell me? Choose any M. After certain stage, my AK should be strictly less than M. Whatever M is giving me, after certain stage, all my AK should be to the left of M. When it diverges to plus infinity, after nth stage, all my AK will be to the right of M. Do all of you agree with that? Understand? Quick. And similar. Okay. There is also another notion. What do I mean by X going to plus infinity or X going to minus infinity? Because L'Hopital's rule deals with this kind of symbols. So you should be crystal clear what is meant by that. In fact, I need it only towards the third case. Maybe I can even skip it. No. In the second case also, I need this notion. So let me do that. So let us assume L is a finite limit. And whereas I want to say limit x going to infinity of fx equal to L. So what is the meaning of this? The meaning is you fix L. It's a finite number. Therefore, I can form the interval L minus epsilon to L plus epsilon. You give me an epsilon positive, then I find that. Now, since I want to say x goes to infinity, that means the domain of f should contain, after certain thing, certain r, it will contain all points. Okay, that is, the domain of f should be something like r to infinity is what you call. That is, f greater than r for some r. Okay, therefore, this makes sense. Now, what I mean is, there exists an m. Let us call it A, so that let me do that A. I want to use R for this. Okay. When I say limit x tends to infinity of fx equal to L, if you give me an epsilon, there exists an R positive, so that for all x greater than R, my fx should lie here. Lies in this interval.
For all x.
Please do not confuse. Okay, domain of the function I said is a to infinity, right? So you give me an epsilon, I want to say there is an r positive, so that for all x greater than r, this must happen. Naturally, since I want to make sure fx, okay, that x must be greater than A. Therefore, if you want, you can also say R is greater than A. But that is immaterial. But the crucial thing is R. How many of you understood or how many of you got confused? See, this clearly shows you have not seen my video on limits. Am I right? Or you have seen, but you just paid very less attention. What is the point of putting a lot of effort in explaining? One gets depressed when one sees the chances. Are you following? If you think you understood, let me ask you. Limit extends to A. Now A is a finite real number and fx equal to plus infinity. What should be the meaning? This is my A. Okay. What should be the meaning? This again says the same thing. So you give me any M real number. Okay. There exists a delta positive, so that for every x in the interval a minus delta to a plus delta, fx should be greater than m. So for everything. Again, you can look at the picture. The picture shows this. This is my a. This is y equal to m line. Okay, the moment you keep on raising the bar, then I have to choose a small interval. Okay, this is a minus delta to a plus delta. For every x, the graph will be somewhere like this. Yeah. I mean, this is not a graph because it has a 2 points. I'm just showing. Okay, it has to be somewhere here. It should be above m. If you raise this m, then I have to shrink this still. It will be above here. If you raise still m, then I have to go slow. It's really bad. If you have seen this, I could have spared all these 10 minutes of this explanation. How many of you understand? Okay. Now, I want you to pay attention. I am going to call out somebody. You have to explain. What is the meaning of limit x goes to infinity of fx equal to minus infinity? See, there are 15 limits which I have dealt with in my video. And I even gave a very simple geometric way of looking at it. I'll just give the simplest case of L'Hopital's rule. So what does it deal with? I'll deal with the A, a real number, and maybe the limit may be, when I write limit x tends to A, it may be both sided limit, or it may be tending to only from the right side or tending to the left side, whatever it may. Okay. But I will treat the case two sided limit to make simple life is simple. So let us assume limit x tends to A of fx is 0 is also limit x tends to A of gx. Both are 0. Then I want to talk about limit fx by gx as x tends to a. So this is one of the L'Hopital's rule. Okay, in the form of the indeterminate form is 0 by 0. I want to deal with this. So what is our assumption? The assumption is, let us assume limit f dash of x by g dash of x as x goes to a is L. Then I want to say this limit is L. This is all I want to say. But there are a lot of assumptions I have to make. Do you understand this? This is 0 by 0 form. Then what do? F dash x by g dash x. If the limit exists, call it. That's what you do, right? So what are the assumptions? The assumption is this. Okay, we are assuming f and g are continuous where on some interval minus a. So this may be my interval, a may be left out, and f is continuous on the interval except perhaps at a, because f at a may not even be defined. But what I know is limit x tends to a of fx is 0, limit x tends to a of gx is 0. That much is given to me. Okay. Now, next I want to talk about, I remember my high school, I want to say this limit is same as limit extends to a of f dash x by g dash x. So that means the limit should exist. Let us call it L. So this limit exists. But then to talk of this quotient, g dash x should be non-zero. Therefore, we are going to assume f and g are differentiable, where on j minus a. Why on j minus a? Because f may not even be defined at a. Therefore, yeah, differentiability of f at a or g at a does not make sense. Then I want to make sure g dash x, I want to write it the new denominator. Therefore, I should assume g dash x is not zero for every x in the interval minus a. These are the hypothesis. You understand this? I'm not writing like a textbook. I know the theorem. I want to write it. Then try to make up the correct hypothesis so that all these things make sense. How many of you understood what I did? Okay. Is that all right? So let me quickly go through the thing. J is an interval. A is a point of the interval. Let's assume J is open. The RA is an interior point. Then f and g are continuous function on the interval j except at a point a. And we assume limit extends to a of fx is 0. So is the limit gx as extends to a. Next, we are assuming f and g are differentiable on j minus a. And I'm also assuming g dash x is non-zero. Therefore, this quotient makes sense, f dash x by g dash x. Then I'm assuming limit extends to a of f dash x by g dash x exists and it is equal to L. And L is finite. L is a real number. These are the assumptions. Then what I want to say? Okay, the conclusion. Conclusion is limit extends to a of fx by gx is limit extends to a of f dash x by g dash x, which we know is L. This is the conclusion. The proof is very easy, and I think we will be within our limit to finish the proof. Is there a way to make extend f and g on the entire j? Remember, f and g are defined only on j minus a, but this is extra hypothesis given to me, limit extends to a of fx equal to 0. So I want to know whether I can extend f to a continuous function on j, on the entire j. Can somebody tell me the answer?
Sir, we can take f of a and g of a both are equal to 0, maybe.
Correct, right. So we define f of a equal to 0 equal to g of a. You understand? Even if f were defined, we are throwing it out. Okay, f at a might have been defined possibly, I don't know. But we are going to define, set f of a equal to 0, g of a. Then f and g are continuous at a. And they are already continuous at j minus a. Therefore, it is continuous and therefore continuous on j. Do you agree with that? Because continuity means limit extends to a of fx should be equal to f of a. But we know limit extends to a of fx is 0. And our f of a by our definition is 0. Therefore, f is continuous at a. It's already continuous at other points. Therefore, it's continuous on g. Similarly, g. Do you agree with that? Right. Yeah? Okay. Now, let's look at. So f of x minus f of a by g of x minus g of a. Right? So for x, so a is here, x is in the interval g. You understand this? X is somewhere. You just, maybe x is here or maybe x is here. I don't care. Can I form this? Right. Now notice that the function f is continuous on this interval a to x and differentiable on the interval a open interval a to x, because at a I do not know. Do you go back? Do you understand this? Because the original thing f and g are differential only on j minus a, so at a I have no idea. You understand? But Cauchy's mean value theorem can be used now, because f and g are continuous on the interval ax or in the interval xa, right? And it is differentiable on the open interval xa or the open interval ax. Therefore, by Cauchy's mean value theorem, what do I know? Let me just look at only one case so that I don't get confused. So there exists a t, that t may depend upon x, so that this is f dash t minus g dash t. Do all of you agree with this? Say yes if you agree. Okay. Remember, this t depends on x, it's not independent, right? So very easily you can say take limit x tends to a equal to limit x tends to a, right, of this, and limit x tends to a of this, then this is, now what is f of a? F of a is zero. F g of a is also zero. Therefore, it is limit x tends to a of fx by gx. And here it will be limit f dash x by g dash x extends to a, but that's not correct. You see that there is a t and the t keeps varying with x. But intuitively it looks as x tends to a. Many times teachers will say a is here, x is there, t is there. As x tends to a, t also tends to a. Therefore, we will write this t. Okay, that's not a very correct argument. Even though it's acceptable, it's not a very precise argument. But many books and teachers will immediately conclude that. So the only way we can, are you following me? I'm becoming more and more, I'm losing my confidence. Yeah?
It's okay, sir.
Okay. So I have to be careful. So what I want to do is, what do I want to show? I want to show fx by gx, the limit as x tends to a equal to L. That means I have to estimate this. Do you understand this? But this object, because fx by gx is same as f dash t by g dash t, where t is tx minus L. Do you understand this? Yeah? So I want to show this is less than epsilon whenever 0 less than mod x minus a less than delta. Do you understand? This is what I want to show. But what is known to me? I know this. Limit x tends to a of f dash x by g dash x is equal to L, right? Therefore, if you give me epsilon, okay, give for this epsilon, there is a delta positive, so that 0 less than mod x minus a less than delta will imply modulus of f dash x minus g dash x minus L is less than epsilon. Do you understand this? Okay. Right? Okay. Now, therefore, choose delta, keep this delta, choose x so that mod x minus a is less than delta and of course greater than 0. Then where is tx? So this is in a minus delta to a plus delta. Do you understand this? This x is. Therefore, my t will also lie in the interval a minus delta to a plus delta. Do you understand? Therefore, f dash of t, this t lies in the interval a minus delta to a plus delta, g dash of t, the same t lies in the interval. Therefore, f dash by g dash minus L because of this will be less than epsilon. How many of you understood the proof? See, it's a very careful proof. You understood that? And the same thing with the t. If t is here also, it's the same thing. If my x is here, then t will be here between x and a. Therefore, t again lies in a minus delta to t, a plus delta. Therefore, f dash t by g dash t will be less than L because that t satisfies this condition. Okay? So, pause, review, proceed. And the same proof you can modify. If x tends to a is one-sided limit, then again the same proof will go. Except I will not look at a minus delta to a or a to a plus delta, depending upon which side limit you are doing. The proof is exactly the same. So even though the proof I gave it for two-sided limit, if x tends to a plus of fx equal to this, the same kind of proof will go through. Similarly, limit x tends to b minus. Okay. Are you following me? Okay. Now the next thing is exactly the same hypothesis, except I am assuming a to be infinity. That is, I am assuming limit x tends to infinity of fx is 0 equal to limit x tends to infinity of gx. But the result is the same. Limit x tends to infinity of f dash x by g dash x is L. This is again in a real number. Then what do I want to conclude? Limit x tends to infinity of f of x by g of x equal to L. This is the conclusion. Except a is not infinity. That's all the difference. Right? Okay. Now this case can be reduced to the earlier case. The reason is, let's look at 0 and take any positive, take it for example 1, and look at anything here towards infinity, right? Now notice that, look at t here and take it to 1 by t. Or x here, take it to 1 by x. Do you understand this? As t goes to 0 plus, 1 by t goes to infinity. Do you understand this? Are you following? T. Yeah? Can you prove it? Because I made a definition. I have to prove this. How will I prove this? To prove 1 by t goes to infinity, what should I do? Give me any m. Okay. Then I have to find a delta. That this is 0, this is delta. If t is here, then I have to say 1 by t is greater than m. You understand this? Now, what is 1 by t greater than m? Remember, 1 by t is already positive. And I can assume m to be positive, otherwise there is nothing to prove. Therefore, I can also assume m is positive, right? This means, can somebody tell me t is less than 1 by m? Therefore, I can take delta to be 1 by m. Are you following? I have to show 1 by t goes to infinity. So, you are going to give me m positive. Then I have to find a delta so that for every t in the interval 0 to delta, 1 by t should be greater than m. Right? That since everything is positive, I can take reciprocal. That means t must be less than 1 by m. Therefore, I can take delta to be 1 by m. Then this is automatically true. You follow that? Therefore, I can reduce this case by looking at, okay, f of t equal to f of 1 by t and g of t equal to g of 1 by t. And this is an if and only. Okay. I proved one way. You can check the other way. Exactly the same argument. Okay. Now what happens? Notice that as t go to infinity, f of 1 by t, that is 1 by t goes to infinity. Therefore, this is same as limit x goes to infinity of fx. And similarly, t going to infinity of g of t equal to limit x going to infinity of g of x. You follow that? But this one I know how to deal with. Sorry, d goes to 0. Why nobody corrected me? Right? This case is what we dealt with earlier. One-sided limit. You understand that? Therefore, limit t going to 0 plus of f of 1 by t is g of 1 by t. Notice that as t goes to 0, f of 1 by t is same as limit f goes to infinity of f of x, but that is 0. Therefore, this is 0 by 0 form. But according to L'Hopital's room case 1, this is same as take the derivative. The derivative will give me minus 1 by t squared into f dash of 1 by t and 1 by t squared into g dash of 1 by t. This cancels and this is as a limit. Okay. As t goes to 0 plus, which is same as saying limit x going to infinity of f dash x by g dash x, which is equal to L. Okay. Please go through it.